Jim Ebert.
They're screwed, but yeah.
You're not going to do a, all right, come in, we'll just record six songs, I'll charge you by the hour. That's not your style. You're going to sit there and you're going to help develop their song and develop their sound.
Yeah.
You're not one of these guys that's just going to be like, okay, 6 hours, let's go.
That's not the way to make music. You know what I mean?
And that's not your style.
That's not my style. You know, when you're a staff engineer, that's what you have to do as an engineer, right? Because they book 11 to 5, that's their time frame, right? I don't work for the studio I used to, you know, back 25 years ago. So I'm a liaison for both people, right? The studio's been kind enough to set all this up for me. And the artist, certainly if there's issue with anything, right? There's no issues with stuff that I work on. I'm studio to client, right?
Right.
Now I'm in the middle, right?
Right.
So if there's something screwed up, even if the client doesn't know it, I'm the one, I'm like, we fix that. So I help them control their budget, right? That's part of my job. It's like, we need this song done for $2,000, everything done. And my job is to do that. Right, and get them to their goal, which is something that sounds accessible, right? If they're trying to sound like John Mayer, or they're no one's trying to sound like anybody.
But, yeah, everybody's original. Yeah,
but what do you guys sound like? Well, we don't really sound like anybody. Yes, you do. Well, who do you guys, in the ballpark?
It's funny that you say that, because I every time I do these interviews, I go, I know everybody's original in your own sound, but who do you sound like? Everybody sounds like somebody. Everybody ripped something off.
Right, at this point.
Yeah.
So, or just a direction. I don't need you to say, we sound just like you too. We want to sound like that record. Right. I don't need you to say that. All you have to say is, we're kind of like in that Coldplay U2 world. Then I know.
Then you have an idea of what you're working on.
Yeah, I know how much time it's going to take based on what I've seen these guys play. You know, because if they come in, now the exception in my Song a Day rule is if you're a more Americana kind of artists, drive-by truckers, where you just want it to be,
right, I understand,
thorns and mistakes, and I'm good with that too. Those, a lot of those records live a long time because of the thorns, and they're more take-based. One of the favorite records that I've done is an artist named Matthew Ryan, who lives in Nashville, and it was more based on that particular take, right?
Right.
So
right.
Everyone was great. That helped, right? The two guitar players were Jay Joyce and Doug Lancio, who are both producers, who play guitar.
Well, that brings me to another question. Do you, when you're first starting to work with a band, do you find that when you get them in there, I mean, they may have a great song, but they're just not up to it musicianship-wise. They can't play their instruments the way you need them to play it for the benefit of the song. Do you find that?
Sometimes.
And is that a problem that sometimes you go, look, you just can't play this guitar part, I'm going to have to bring somebody else in.
Or I'll do it.
Or you'll do it?
Yeah.
Okay. Does that cause problems?
I will talk about it beforehand.
Okay. Once again, picking your spots. Right?
I won't go, give me the guitar, I'm playing it. I'll say, you know, I really need to get this done by 9 o'clock tonight, right? So
give me the guitar.
No, we're spending a little too much time right here on this. Can I just, your feelings be okay if I grab it and just do that part real quick so we can move on?
So you don't necessarily have to bring in other musicians because you can play the music parts that need to be done?
In that scenario, that would be more appropriate. Because now if he's not playing the part or getting it, and we're there, though, we're in the moment, so it's easy for me to grab it. I'm not going to call someone, right?
Right.
And I would know in pre-production if it was, you know, a completely not happening thing guitar-wise, and I would have that discussion.
Because that would drive your costs up if you have to bring in other musicians, right?
Yeah, and I have a lot of artists that are solo artists, and I hire the whole band, right? Mm-hmm. I have a group of players that I use around town, and for certain genres, and you know they're great, and they come in quick and do it. And yeah, it does cost you money, but it's quick, and at the end of the day, your record sounds good.
So now that we've gone through, now if I am in a band and I want to hire you, what's the best way to do? Start out with an email, show up here.
If you have property in St. John's, you can probably barter with me. No, just hit my email, ebertaudio@gmail.com, And you can certainly just, anyone at any point in time, if they want to have a discussion about making music, that's fine.
Let's talk a little bit about you now.
Okay. All right. I thought we were.
Well, I want to talk about you as a musician, not as a producer.
All right.
You're from this area, right?
Right, right. Grew up here.
Okay. And I think I read on your website, this is something you and I share in common. The first song you ever learned to play on a synthesizer was Smoke on the Water, right?
Probably so, yes.
And then you were hooked.
Yeah.
That was the first song I ever learned how to play on guitar, right. Although I never progressed past that. I'm still just playing Smoke on the Water.
Right, right. I can show you the easy way to do it.
So you started out in bands? I mean, what were your influences? How did you start out? How did you get to be the Jim Ebert?
This is not going to reflect well on me. I loved the Partridge Family when I was like 7 years old.
Wow.
Right?
But so they didn't play their instruments.
Well, you're seven. You don't care about that,
yeah,
right?
That's true.
Right? So I started playing, just messing around, started on the keyboard around 11, got the bug of doing it a little more seriously. So
keyboard was your first instrument?
Keyboard, right, okay. Right. So I had a Wurlitzer electric piano and a Micromoog when I was 12 in my room. And I just spent all my time in there playing Elton John to Smoke on the Water, to whatever I could learn, you know, and I learned it wrong and played them wrong for years and probably still do, but got the bug there, then got my best friend involved in guitar, and then I got my other best friend to play bass, and we just evolved from there, and we stayed together, actually, for about 8 years.
And that was in this area?
Yeah, around. So we played...
What was the name of your band?
We were called Journey. We were called.
Wow, I think I've heard your stuff.
Right? Yeah, we sold a few records. We were called Sudden Attack, and we just played.
We were called Journey.
We played at bars and colleges and stuff like that through high school, and it was great.
And what kind of music did you guys play?
We mainly did.
You didn't sound like anybody, right?
We didn't sound like anybody. We're original, man. We were kind of Brit rock influenced. You know what I mean? We played a lot of Beatles and The Who, that kind of stuff. We also had like 50 original songs that we had written.
Wow, 50.
So we would split it up, you know what I mean? And we would just play like half and half whenever we could, going out.
And what happened? I guess you guys were together for 8 years, and I guess it didn't happen for you.
Right. Well, we actually did. We did a few recordings, and then the last
and,
round.
And I don't mean that in a derogatory sense.
No, no, no.
It didn't happen that you weren't Journey.
Right.
So.
And we weren't.
Right.
On many levels. We went into one of the third or fourth studios we went to was Q in Jeffrey, the owner's, his basement of his parents' house.
Okay.
Right? So that's where we ended up. And we were doing a demo, and we kind of broke up there. The guitar player kind of wanted to go more synth pop, and the bass player was getting married, and the drummer and I were just kind of left out on the island, right? He went to college. I failed out of college. So I was like, what can I do if I fail out of college? Well, I can do this, right? Because I was kind of, at that point, doing our record anyway, the band record in the studio. I was kind of running stuff just by using synthesizers and all that kind of stuff at a young age. I kind of had an idea what dials were and all that kind of stuff. Okay? And got thrown in the fire. Just the Jeff, who owned the studio, sort of started a painting company.
You're having the same talking problem that I was having.
Painting company. And he's like, you know, can you do this? And I said, well, I'll try. And I did. And got better at it and got a reputation for doing it.
So you're self-taught?
Fairly. Yeah. Okay. And you learn stuff, you know, as you go along. You read this or that. Or I took a few classes. I don't think they helped a whole lot. And then just kept evolving, and you know, we got crazy, and we leased this space upstairs where Studio A was built, and I sort of ran the basement studio while that was being built, moved up here, and now there's five rooms here. So anyway, it was the hobby that went to hell. Still love what I do, right?
Right. And when did you decide that this is what you wanted to do versus being in a band? Because, I mean, it's to me, it sounds like you're like, yeah, my band broke up. I'm kind of in between right now, and he've asked me to help out. I mean, did you ever think about going back to playing in a band, or did just so take off for you that, you know, this is where I think my talent lies?
I think at an early age, I realized that the playing level I was going to get to. Right? At about 20, I said, you know, this is what I like playing. This is as good as I'm going to get. I'm not going to be Steve Vai, and nor do I want to be Steve Vai. I'd rather be Tom Petty.
Right.
Right? My singing was okay, but not great. I kind of felt like I had hit the maximum. Hit the maximum threshold at 20 of where I was going to do instrumentally. Right? And to be honest with you, I didn't really have a craving to go jump in a van and drive across the country and do all that stuff or try to find it. I mean, work for years to become a band and then get in a van and suffer for another 5 years. I don't think I had the patience for that. Like, I tell people when they come in here, I'm like, this is the easy part. Coming in here and making a great record is the easy part, but you've got to have the tenacity if you want to survive and make yourself this. If this is what you want to do for
and
a living.
You've got to survive the perils of the road.
Well, you got to do all of it. You got to.
I mean, that's where it's the hardest part, right? Because you got to live with these guys that are in your band that you start out as friends, and
yeah,
you know, you want to kill each other.
Yeah, well, that happens. Yes, yes, all of that happens. But I mean, the other thing is, I just had a young intern here earlier, and just like you have to be tenacious with what if you're trying to make your living as a musician, artist, right? You need to be your best self promoter. You've got to be your best manager. You've got to be all of it. And if you don't have that drive, if you think I'm just an awesome artist and something will land in my lap, you're narrowing your odds greatly. So like I said, this is the easy part. We're going to have a great time. You're going to come in. We're going to record. We're going to make it as good as it can be. You're going to be happy. You're going to play it for all your friends. They're going to love it. Your parents are going to love it. We got to get the 1,000 people that don't know you to love it, right? And you've got to get to those 1,000 people. And they're like, Jim, well, don't you do that? And I don't do that. I don't go distributing your CDs down in Pennsylvania.
Which goes back to what you said. I do this for a reason. I don't want to be in the van. I don't want to be out promoting. You do this. This is what you do.
Right.
And you made a almost a lifestyle choice.
Yeah.
But
yeah,
got
absolutely.
To stay in music.
Right. Yeah, absolutely.
You know, and it's a common tale, you know, you get out there and these guys, they just can't take the perils of the road. They can't stand to be around each other, and it's hard. I mean, Phil and I do this show part-time. We don't live together, and we're ready to kill each other.
Yeah.
All the time over this show.
Well, I
can't even imagine traveling around the country with this guy. I'd slit his throat.
Right. Nice. Well, and you get that in here as well, because, I mean, granted, you know, you're a group of young men that are four or five of you together all the
right.
time. There's always something going on between two people, right? It changes.
Some kind of drama.
It always changes. And you have to put a third ear in the back of your head and be cognizant of what's going on around you.
Once again, it goes to you picking your spots and how to deal with
exactly
the artists and, you know.
And I do consciously listen to everything. So, except if, you know, the drummer's saying something that's completely wrong.
So, there's a lot more to what you do.
Notice I said drummer.
Yeah. Yeah, they're a bit of a problem.
Right.
There's a lot more to what you do, then, than just coming in here and turning knobs and fixing the audio levels.
No, and I tell everybody, I don't do that anymore. I know the gear I want was put in here when I moved back.
Right.
It's gear I use everywhere. If I go to LA, I'm using those mic pieces. I'm using this. I'm using that. And I've always relied on a really good engineer. I was an engineer, and
right.
I can still do it. And I mix my own records for the most part, but I rely on people heavily because I'm trying to balance the artistic side
right.
of the group. Right. I'm listening to it, listening to what they're saying. Even though I'm sitting here listening to the speakers, listening to the guitar performance, I'm hearing the bass player saying, "I should have put a riff right there." You know what I mean? So I'm
right.
calculating. I'm going, okay, you know, there's 3 minutes open because someone's going to get coffee. Hey, grab your bass. Let's put that. Let's do it real quick. So you're absorbing a lot. So you're back to your question. It's easily 50% psychology.
Yeah.
Easily.
You've got to be a negotiator, a moderator, almost a babysitter. Just everything. There's a lot. It seems there's a lot that goes into it than other. Hey, man, we can jam. We're just going to show up and play for you.
Right. Absolutely. If you're trying to be a commercially viable, you know what I mean? Like, if you're aspiring to be on, again, DC 101 or 98 right. Rock or whatever the case may be, those records are pretty polished. So, I mean, I literally had a guy, you know, come to me and say, you know, I want to really get that Nickelback sound at home. And I'll say, well, what are you using? And he'll say, well, I'm using 257s and the mic pre's that came with the Pro Tools. And I just say, you're not going to get that sound. You're not. And they'll say, well, why not? And I'm going to say, well, because there's $100,000 of microphones and mic pre's and mic set up properly in the perfect recording space, and then they're quantizing all your drums, triggering sounds, they're doing all this stuff. Can you get a drum sound with two mics? Yes, just not that one.
Right. I think that was when I was trying to be a musician when I was growing up, one of the things that frustrated me the most, and now as I've gotten older, I understand it more, is I always tried to sound like the records, and I'm like, I would get frustrated. I was like, I don't sound like that, but it's a lot of what you were saying goes into it. There's a lot more of the production end and the money and everything else.
Yeah, but even, you know, with a singer, you're who you are.
I'm just talking about guitar. I mean, I couldn't get my guitar to sound that way.
Right. That's a whole nother topic. I mean, the tone comes from your hands. You can plug into a paper bag if you've got the great, great hands.
Yeah, I didn't really have any of it. That's why I'm a lawyer. But
can I have a loan?
My parents bored the shit out of the neighbors. But let's talk a little bit more about you. This is a lot of fun for me. This is really fascinating. You got your so-called, and correct me if I'm wrong, your big break with Shy.
Right.
Which was an a cappella group
right.
from this area, correct?
Right.
So you go out to L.A., you're living the dream, but you're doing R&B, right?
Yeah.
Because you're pigeonholed into that genre because of getting out there. Am I right about that?
That era, which would be the early 90s, when people they had their thing, right? It wasn't cool to do multiple genres. Right. Very few people could do that and get away with it.
So you were doing mostly R&B when you went out to L.A., right?
Yeah.
And what were some of the other R&B acts you were working with?
There was a group, they were called To the Extreme. They had a single. They were from this area as well. George Benson, I worked at a couple sessions with him. Again, Shy, their whole second record. What's the actor's name? It's escaping me. He was on Living Color. I can't think of his name. Jamie Foxx.
Jim Carrey?
Jamie Foxx. Jim Carrey, right. His R&B career.
Yeah, Jim Carrey's R&B career. So you did a Jamie Foxx record?
Yeah, just random stuff. I did a lot of mixing, right? I didn't do any producing. It was all mix work.
Would that be more in the vein of engineering mixing?
Yeah, it's the final stage.
Okay.
Right? Blending everything together.
How did you get back into doing rock and roll? Because that was your first love, right? Rock and roll.
Yeah,
playing Smoke on the Water.
Yeah. And Dreamweaver.
Great song.
Yeah, yeah. That was on the move. I had gotten to a point where I, at that era of hip-hop and R&B was so, the instruments were so plugged in, so to speak, and sampled, which was fine. It made me learn all of that, which was great. But I really just had really missed rock bands and guitars and all of that kind of stuff.
So how did you get back to it?
Well, it was a funny thing because I was in Las Vegas and I got a call from a friend of a friend who said, our engineer, Joe Ciccarelli, a pretty prominent engineer, just canceled on our session for the record that's supposed to start for Capitol tomorrow.
Can you do it?
For Jason Faulkner. I said, I'll be there. And that was it.
And that was that Jason Faulkner album.
Yeah, he was
playing
Jason.
Played a little bit of that for me earlier.
Yeah, he was in Jellyfish. Amazing, you know, player. Like, plays everything. Not like technically amazing, but just melodically. You know, it's like
right.
having McCartney in the room with you.
Really?
Yeah. Yeah, plays everything. Played everything on the record.
Well, I'm actually going to go download that album on the iTunes based on your recommendation. Because
Author Unknown, that one's called. And that was 15 years ago, and it, you know, it's another one of those, he got signed, you know, the record president, vice president's showing up at the sessions, we love the record, A&R guy gets fired, vice president moves to another label, Jason's record, you know, gets no love. That's the way it works. A lot.
That a lot of it's luck and timing, right, Jim?
Yes. A lot. It just, it's, it, yes, timing. Thank you. Yeah, so I've had a few of those records where, you know, the A&R guy left, got fired, president changed. And they bring in their whole team, and they have a roster of artists already. So, you know, you got to have a lot of good fortune. A record deal is not the end goal. Success is the end goal.
And how did you end up working with one of my favorite bands and one of my favorite artists, Marvelous Three?
I was at South by Southwest, and a friend of mine who knew I was a huge Cheap Trick fan, this was about 18 years ago, maybe?
Yep, it's probably about right.
Just was like, you got to see this band. I know you're a Cheap Trick fan. So I went and saw them, and I thought they were just amazing, right? I was like, how do I not know this band? Then I asked Butch, who I just met, I said, what label are you on?
And we say Butch, you mean Butch Walker, right?
Who I didn't know.
As everybody knows who watches the show, probably after Kiss, because everybody knows my love of Kiss, Butch Walker is probably my favorite artist.
And Kiss is probably Butch's, so that's funny.
Really?
Yeah.
I didn't know that.
Motley Crue or Kiss, probably. Yeah.
Man, that's awesome.
Now you're in love.
yeah, I am, actually. That's cool.
I went up to him, and I just like, what label are you on? We're not. Okay, so we started a dialogue. He started sending me in the mail songs because we didn't have the internet, right?
Right. That's,
you could send songs on. So I'd get these.
Before the internet machine?
The internet machine probably was just getting turned on at that point. So he'd send me songs, and they were all, you know, just great songs. Right, so I'm thinking, if nothing else, he's going to be a great, you know, songwriter,
right.
And his. But I took him to a label called Red Ant that actually had Shy, and they had Sublime as well. So they had some success. And then the head of that label went to go see them, wanted to make an offer, but it was too late by that point. They signed to Elektra. So we did the Elektra record and had a great time. It was a great record.
So then you guys co-produced, which... it is my favorite album. I mean, there's not to quote a friend of mine who used to say, not a bad chord on it. I mean, that is just an incredible album.
Right.
And then the rest is history. You went on to do that, right?
Did that one. And, you know, when you have songs like that, it's cool because there's really no rules, right?
Yeah.
You can put almost anything in them, you know, put silly shit here and there, and we did.
Yeah.
And we love it, right? But when the songs are that great and pop like that... the only thing that went wrong was it just didn't sell 5 million records like everyone thought it would.
Yeah, and it had that minor hit on it, which should have been a big hit, Freak of the Week.
Right, which was a hit great before, song. Before the record deal was even signed, that song was getting played.
Yeah, and then they did a video, and it was a minor hit on MTV, and it's just such a great song. And if you get a chance, go pick up the Marvelous 3 Hey album. You can check out Jim's work on it. It's just a great... pop, rock and roll album.
Right. Power pop.
Power pop. Absolutely. Awesome. And then you went on to work on a couple of Butch's solo records, right?
The one I did just a little additional production on Lefty Center. But I was pretty involved in Letters.
Which is my favorite Butch album.
Which is mine as well.
Great album.
And
great album.
Just had a blast. We cut it, I think it was 8 days, and I think we mixed it in 4. Something like that. So there was just not overthinking, you know, hey, let's use the Vox on that. Hey, that sounds great. Let's use the Vox on that. Hey, that sounds great. Let's use the Vox on that. All right. Yeah. All right. You're going to do piano. It seems like a good time for you to do that song, Joan. Go out. Why don't you, and he'll be, you know,
I
can do it.
My producers tell me we're coming to the end of our time, and maybe we can do another show with you. Cause I'd love to break down those Butch Walker albums with you. But, you know, the show isn't all about me, even though I think it is sometimes when I tell Phil that and we fight. What else would you like to say in closing? I know you do some teaching besides producing. Let's talk more about you.
Yeah, so I do still travel a bit. Once in a while, I did this group Hot Shell Ray last year and All Time Low out in California. So once in a while, I still get a chance to move around. And I also have started teaching this year. So I teach music production here at the studio. And
so same way to contact you through your email?
Yeah. And it's a certified school and all that happy stuff. So I'm certifiable and we knew this.
Yes.
So anyway, the school's great because it's a working studio as a school. So my guys, I get in here, my students, they're hands-on, second day. We're going.
That's cool.
Yeah.
So and is that the same kind of thing? It's a price range, or is there a set price?
Yeah,
there's
different hourly courses. You know,
different
one-on-one, small group, large group, blah, blah, blah.
Okay, and we can find out all that information by contacting you?
Yeah, or they can go to Q Recording, cuerecording.com.
Okay, well, we're coming to the end here. I want to thank you, Jim, for sitting down with me.
Thank you.
Hopefully I can talk Phil into us doing another show where we can break down these albums a little bit.
I forgot to mention one thing.
Yes.
I started a record company.
Please.
Called Big Enough Umbrella, and it is a series of records that I have two done at this point, and it's what's called Decatree Recording, where there are three mics on this 6-foot pole, and that's what I use to record. So
okay.
They're mainly acoustic-based records.
Okay.
But I've done one with Honor by August.
Okay.
And I've done one with Justin Treywick.
And where can we find those albums?
End of the year, they'll be on BigEnoughUmbrella.net.
Can we get them on the iTunes?
Yeah, you will be able to.
We'll be able to. Okay.
But the good thing about it is, it's just an equal split with my record company and the artist, and we do a charity as well attached to the show, because there's 12 or 13 people that come to see the show with a minimum entrance fee that goes to the selected charity for that night.
Okay, great. Is that around here?
Yeah, we do it right here.
Awesome.
Right in there.
Awesome. And can I find out all this information at your
I
website?
I might even
as well?
Have you come out for the next performance and record it.
Oh, cool. But can we find out about all this stuff on your website?
All of it except for the Big Enough Umbrella dates. I'm still developing that.
Okay. But right. you'll give us a link to that from your website.
Yes,
when eventually.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
Very good.
Anything else?
Unless there's one Marvelous Three, what was it? What was it in that song? Or
I'm going to talk Phil into doing some more footage, so we're gonna go through that.
But I get this question. I'll answer it real quick. Roxanne is the one song that he sings on the record.
You're not
the same. He sings Roxanne in the very beginning of the song. Because some people ask me, what song is he singing?
That's right.
Right.
Well, Jim, thanks.
Yeah, man.
I appreciate it.
Yeah.
I also want to thank my good friend Johnny Oak from Cascadence. He's the one. You've been talking to him and about his band. You've seen him on the show. Everybody knows, I think, the world of them. He told me that you were in my area, and he's the one that hooked us up.
Thank him as well.
So thank you, Johnny. And as always, thanks
Phil.
Thank you, Phil. And even though we fight all the time, you know I love you. This is Dave Vain, and I'm in the front row with Jim Ebert. Thanks for watching.